what is the PCUSA, which is our denomination, but stance on homosexuals and same gender relationship in church leadership? How does UPC align with this stance? And why is probably a question I have to wrestle with more than you. But I just wonder if you could share, given your reading of the New Testament and issues of leadership and the various offices that we see there as you read it, how should we be thinking about qualifications for those offices, particularly among those of us who may be same-sex attracted or have different sexual experiences?
Yeah, my simple answer is I think any leadership of any organization or local church should be in a mental agreement with the ethics and doctrine of the church and be striving to follow that, albeit imperfectly. When it gets down to like membership or other aspects of service that aren't leadership, I think there's a lot more gray area there. But for me, I think it would be really confusing for the church, even the people of the church, if the leaders are saying, here's what we believe, and they're clearly not believing that or trying to live according to it. So yeah, I think for me, that seems pretty clear that leaders should be, to be a leader means you're on board with and are agreeing with the church's ethical stance. I think a big one that we need to check ourselves with is consistency. Whatever we say we believe, are we holding all people to that same standard across the board? So if we say, generosity and hospitality are requirements of leaders, then let's make sure we're holding people to that. If we say, if we're not going to let a lesbian couple serve on leadership because that's a violation, then, the deacon who's sleeping with his girlfriend, whatever, like we need to make sure that that's a equally not allowed. So most reasonable people can respect if there's clarity and consistency and humility, I think are the three ingredients that people can respect. I think they may not agree with it. They may still not like it, but if you're being humble, consistent and clear, I think that's most people, appreciate that.
Clarity, consistency, and humility.
Humility. Yeah, if you want another hard kindness, okay, I guess.
Okay, oh, clarity, thank you. Consistency, now we know the kindness. Holy Spirit's at work.
Well, no, I actually think humility is the word I'm going for there, so we're gonna miss out on the acronym.
Let me ask you another one. These are good. Someone wants to know, what are some ways that we as the church can welcome and support and walk with youth struggling with their sexuality?
Yeah, man. I think number one, and this isn't just youth, but is maybe especially for youth. I think we older people, we need to be really good listeners.
What'd you say?
Good listeners.
Oh.
Like, a 15-year-old comes out as non-binary and says they want to be called she and they. It'd be really easy to say, what, non-they? You're one per, like, just kind of had this kind of posture, like, or an eye roll,
Mm-hmm.
I understand. Like, that's like, what world, what's going on here? But like, let's be curious. What is going on here? What does that mean? I'm genuinely interested. Like, oh man, thank you for telling me that. Like, I would love to know more about your story. And even come at this with a posture of learning, be a student of people, not just always a teacher of people. The youth world these days, it really is cross-cultural ministry. I mean, for the first time in the history of human civilization, people are growing up with infinite access to all the information in the world in their pocket by the age of 9, 10, 11, 12. That's never happened before in the history of human civilization. So we are dealing with almost a different people group, same language, same culture, but the technological world they're growing up in is, we don't know. Sociologists don't know what the effects that's going to have on this next generation, probably for a couple of decades, really. So we need to be really, good listeners and learners and be, respect younger people, not just get annoyed at the words they're using or whatever. So kids are, as most of us have probably heard, anxiety, depression, and suicide rates are off the chart with teenagers. A pandemic has only exacerbated that. Social media doesn't seem to be helping. I don't want to joke, but it's like, it seems like such the elephant in the room that few people are willing to admit. It's like, I mean, I think we need to really disciple our kids through how to navigate social media, internet, smartphones. I think that's a huge, huge, huge thing. And they're lonely and isolated, kids are, and they're wanting to belong. They're wanting to be seen, you know? And so we need to see them.
Cross-cultural missionaries with our own children. I think that's a great point. And listening, thank you.